presentations. He was also part of the meeting of the international commission that met in our church here. So this is the last of his talks. Later in the afternoon, we'll drive him to Toronto, where he will leave for London, and finally Oxford. I'll show you in a minute. I'll show you what I'll do in a minute. Just wait. But this talk is a little bit different, you know. But as you see from the faces, this is for young, mostly for young people, our students. This is a talk for OCF, for students of OCF, for young people. And we're very glad you accepted to do also this in the midst of all the other theological and serious talks to an older crowd. Now we have a younger crowd here. Tell me, before we start, we look at you, it's interesting to see where you are from. I see there are some people from Buffalo, right? For sure. What are the other cities where you're coming here? Let's see, I know there are people from Ithaca. Ithaca? Raise your hand from Ithaca. Okay, Ithaca, here you are. Syracuse. Anybody from Syracuse? No. Rochester? Okay. What about, who are the others? From Canada? Where?
Toronto.
Okay, Toronto. Anybody else? Okay, wonderful. We have all of these groups here. Metropolitan Kallistos is a beloved speaker, bishop of our church. He's the bishop of the Ecumenical Patriarchate in Oxford, in England. He was a professor for for about 35 years in Oxford. And he's retired from this position, but he's still, as you see, he's traveling, he's lecturing, he's with us. Many people have found the Orthodox Church because of Metropolitan's writings, especially the classic book, The Orthodox Church. It's the bestseller. In the English language, it's the most known and circulated book about the Orthodox Church. If you have any of his books with you, or if you want to get some of the books over there, he can sign them for you at the end of this presentation. So, His Eminence will give a presentation to you, and then we will have questions and then discussion. All right? Thank you, Eminence.
Given the topic, Why Follow Christ? And that leads us at once to various other questions. Who is Christ? What has he done for me? Indeed, what does it mean to say that Christ is my Savior? I remember once in a railway train, a person sitting in the seat opposite me leant forward and said to me in a very grave tone, "Are you saved?" Well, how did I reply? How would you reply? I'll tell you at the end of my talk how I replied, though I won't tell you now. If we look at the New Testament, we'll find there that there's no single way of understanding the saving work of Christ. There's no single systematic theory. What we have in the New Testament is a whole series of images and symbols set side by side. They are symbols of profound meaning and power, but for the most part they're not explained, they're left to speak for themselves. We don't need to insist on a single image for Christ's work. We can take all of these different ways of speaking and use them side by side. Now, I want to present to you this morning 7 different ways of thinking of the saving work of Christ. But first, let's note that in all cases, there's one fundamental point being made. Jesus Christ, as our Savior, has done something for us that we could not do alone and by ourselves. We cannot save ourselves. We need help. And Christ provides that help. Exactly, he says in St. John's Gospel, "Without me, you can do nothing." Some of you may have read the ghost stories of M.R. James. And one story he has is called A School Story. It tells how boys in class were studying Latin, and they were made to work out a conditional sentence. That means a sentence beginning the words with the word if. And then they all send up their slips of paper with their sentences in Latin. The master takes up the first bit of paper, and as soon as he reads it, he turns pale and rushes out of the room. The boys are naturally puzzled. Who has made such a grievous mistake in Latin grammar that this has had this startling effect on the master? And they go up and look at the piece of paper that has upset him. And what the piece of paper says in Latin is, "Si tu non veneris ad me, ego veniam ad te," which being translated means, "If you won't come to me, I shall come to you." Now, what it was that so frightened the schoolmaster, what he feared would come to him, that I'm not going to tell you. It would spoil the story, and you can find out for yourselves by reading it. But I would like to take that phrase and apply it to Christ. If you don't come to me, I'll come to you. What has happened to us is that we cannot come to God, but Christ has come to us. We can't by our own efforts cross over the abyss which sin has created between us and heaven. So God in Christ has crossed over the abyss and he has come to us. Now I'd like to look at 7 models of what Christ has done for us, which we find in Scripture and in the Christian tradition. The first model is Christ is our teacher. He is the one who reveals the truth to us, who brings us light and disperses the darkness of ignorance in our minds. As it says in the prologue to the Gospel of John, "He was the true light that enlightens everyone who comes into the world." Christ saves us by teaching us the truth concerning God. And that was exactly the way the disciples thought about Christ at first. They used to call him Rabbi, which means teacher. When I go home at night in Oxford, there's a hot dog seller who always calls out to me, "Good night, Rabbi." And I'm very pleased to be called Rabbi because that is an honorable title. It is the title that was given to Christ himself. But later on, of course, the disciples realized that he was not just a human teacher, that he was something much more. So there is the first picture of what Christ has done for us. He saves us by teaching us the truth. And that's a model that Christian writers in the second century were very keen about. The group known as the Apologists, best known of them was Justin Martyr. And they thought of Christ, yes, as teacher. However, clearly that's not the only way of thinking of Christ. And it isn't sufficient, because it leaves out the dimension of tragedy and sin. We do not just wish to be given information when we think of Christ as our teacher, but we want to be saved from sin. And the image of him as teacher is a bit too optimistic. We want more than instruction. So let's look at a second model for Christ. We think of him as paying a ransom on our behalf. It says in Mark 10:45, "The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many." The point of this metaphor is, previously we were enslaved to sin, now we are liberated. As St. Paul says in Galatians 5:1, what Christ has done is to set us free. But this act of liberation on Christ's part was enormously costly. The ransom that he pays on our behalf is nothing less than his own life, laid down for us on the cross. It was no easy task to set us free. An act of arduous reparation was required. So this second model, unlike the first model of Christ as teacher, does take account of the tragedy of sin. But let us remember, this is only an image or metaphor, and we mustn't press it too far. In the course of Christian history, it was often asked, to whom is the ransom paid? And if you start working with that idea, you get into trouble. If you say the ransom was paid to God the Father, you are in danger of separating Christ from God the Father. And you are in danger of thinking of God the Father as somehow angry and wishing to be satisfied with ransom. And that can't be right. We're not to think of God the Father as angry and vindictive and demanding payment. Surely God is not like that. He doesn't require any payment. He wants to forgive us anyway. So, are we to say that the ransom is a payment made to the devil? Some Christian writers worked with that idea and used to talk about the devil's rights. But the devil has no rights. He is a liar. He is an imposter. He is a cheat. So, that can't be right either. The essential point of the ransom metaphor is then not the idea of a transaction or bargain. The essential point is quite simply that of being set free. We need not ask, to whom is the ransom paid? We should stick to the basic point, Christ has set us free. So that's a second model, which is certainly used in Scripture. But then there's a third model. We think of Christ as a sacrifice offered on our behalf. As St. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 5:7, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. And again we say, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So here we think of Christ as the Paschal Lamb who was eaten by the Jews at the Passover in memory of the Exodus from Egypt. Christ's death on the cross and his resurrection are the new Passover. But what does it mean, sacrifice? In the ancient world, pagan and Jewish, sacrifices were offered every day. This was part of the fundamental meaning of religion. No religion without sacrifice. But what does it mean to us today? We don't have the same background as they have. Well, to understand the meaning of sacrifice, let's hold fast to four ideas. A sacrifice, first, is fundamentally an offering or gift made to God. And then secondly, the true sacrifice is to offer to God not an animal or some object, but ourselves. Sacrifice means self-offering. And then in the third place, many people think that the essence of sacrifice lies in death. The death of the sacrificial victim, lamb, goat, or calf, as the case may be. But the true purpose of sacrifice is not death, but life. If the victim is slain, this is not because death has a value in itself. The victim was killed in order to release its life, so that the life could be offered to God. So then, the life of the animal, understood in Old Testament terms, lies in its blood. And pouring out the blood of the victim is a way of offering the victim to Christ, to God, rather. So the third point about sacrifice is it's not concerned about death, but about life. In the fourth place, a sacrifice, in order to be truly a gift or offering, must necessarily be voluntary. That which is taken from us by force, against our will, is not truly a sacrifice. Now we can apply all that to Christ. First, Christ as sacrifice is offered up to God. Second, Christ offers himself in sacrifice. Third, when he dies on the cross, it is that we may have life. This is made abundantly clear when the death on the cross is followed by the life-creating resurrection. And fourthly, Christ was not under any compulsion to die, but he freely laid down his life on our behalf. As he says in John chapter 10, I lay down my life for the sheep. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own account. If Christ had not gone voluntarily to his death, his crucifixion would have been simply a miscarriage of justice, an act of violence. But because he lays down his life willingly, is death becomes a life-creating, self-offering for the sins of the world. Now, underlying the whole idea of sacrifice as voluntary self-offering, there is one all-important factor, and that is love. Why did Christ lay down his life? Out of love. Having loved his own who were in the world, says St. John, chapter 13, 1, he loved them to the uttermost. And we are told, John 3, 16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Love, then, is the key to the whole idea of sacrifice. Sacrifice is voluntary, self-offering, inspired by love. Love to the uttermost. Love without limits. So there is the meaning of our third model of sacrifice. Then there's another model that I don't include in my list. Often in Western theology, it is said that Christ dying on the cross rendered satisfaction to God the Father. That's a theory developed in the West in the 11th century by St. Anselm. But you won't find the word satisfaction in the New Testament. It's not a scriptural word. And I think it implies a legalistic approach. Whereas we should think of the death of the Christ on the cross in terms of divine love. In the Middle Ages, in the West, they thought of God the Father as having had his honor offended by human sin, and Christ renders satisfaction to God's offended honor. Well, these are not scriptural categories. This is not the way the New Testament thinks about Christ. It doesn't talk about God's offended honor. It doesn't talk about Christ rendering satisfaction. So I don't include satisfaction in my list, though you will hear it mentioned by other Christians. But then, a fourth model is substitution, which is not quite the same as satisfaction. Christ, it is said in the New Testament, bears our sins in his own person, and he suffers instead of us. Christ is seen then as the one who suffers and dies on the cross, taking our sins upon himself, enduring the punishment that we deserve to undergo. That's an idea you find in St. Paul, 2 Corinthians 5. For our sake, God made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God. Now, yes, this substitution idea is to be found in Scripture, but I often hear it interpreted in ways that don't satisfy me very well. I remember when I was a student at Oxford, Billy Graham came to preach a mission, and I went and heard him speak about Christ. And he said, at the moment Christ died on the cross, the lightning of God's wrath struck him instead of you. I didn't think that was a very helpful way of thinking about Christ. Are we to think that God is arbitrary, that his spirit is marked by anger, and that his anger is like lightning, and it just happens to hit somebody who is around, and Christ was around, and so it hit him instead of us? All of this is much too external. I would therefore not be very happy about that way of thinking of substitution. I wouldn't really wish to say Christ died instead of me. I would rather say Christ died on behalf of me. Christ is in me and I in him. So I would want to combine the language of substitution with the language of indwelling. Well, not to think of the work of Christ as something purely external to us, but he dies instead of us and we are not involved. But he dies with us on our behalf as our companion. That is the way I would want to take the notion of substitution. Then we come to a fifth model. Victory. Christ's work of salvation is to be seen as a victory over sin, death, and darkness. And this is underlined in the last word of Christ in St. John's Gospel. He says, "It is finished." John 19:30. Now, "it is finished" shouldn't be seen as a cry of despair and hopelessness. Christ is not saying it's all over, nothing more can be done. No, what it means is it is completed, it is fulfilled, it is accomplished. Christ, as he dies on the cross, utters a word of great hope and power. A word of victory. And what is fulfilled, accomplished, completed? We may say Christ's death is the victory of suffering love. Christ has to endure all manner of suffering, not only of body but of soul. He suffers physically when he says on the cross, "I thirst," but he suffers much more from a sense of loneliness and betrayal and desertion, so that he even says on the cross, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" So the powers of evil, the powers of darkness, of despair, of hopelessness, attack Christ on the cross. But they do not overcome him. As we've already said, love was what brought him to his crucifixion. And he continues to love his own to the uttermost, to the end. So what we see on the cross is a victory of a very unusual kind, not a victory by military power and superior force. We see the victory of suffering love. Christ is victorious over all the powers of darkness in the universe because without imposing himself, without aggression, he continues to love all of us to the very end. So there we see the kind of victory that Christ wins. Not a military victory, but a sacrificial, self-emptying victory. Then, yes, we have a sixth instance of what Christ's work means, and that is example. Christ sets us a supreme example of suffering love. This is very close to the last one, the victory of suffering love. Now, the idea of Christ setting us an example has been very popular in 20th century writers. It moves completely away from the notion of God as angry and jealous, as vindictive and bloodthirsty. It moves away from legalistic categories like satisfaction. It moves away from any militaristic imagery of a battle. Instead, it interprets God and his salvation in terms of love. But the idea of Christ setting us an example is not by itself sufficient. There's a story told of the great Scottish commander, Robert the Bruce, in the 13th century. He was fighting against the invading English, and he had been repeatedly defeated. One day, after a severe reverse, he was sitting alone in a room and he thought, it's no good, I must give up. No point in going on fighting. Then he looked up and he saw a spider that had fallen out of its web and was trying to get back again. It kept pulling itself up by the thread on which it was hanging, and it kept falling back. But it went on trying until at last it managed to get back into the web. Robert Bruce applied the example to himself. He decided to go and fight the English one more time. And on that final occasion, he defeated them completely. Now, the spider may have encouraged Robert the Bruce by setting him an example of persistence. But the spider didn't actually change anything in the outward objective situation of the Scottish commander. It only set him an example. So we have to ask, has Christ on the cross done no more for us than the spider did for Robert the Bruce? Has he just set us an example, but nothing more? Does he just leave us to follow his example by our own efforts, relying on our own strength? Surely that's not enough. We do not just want Christ to set us an example. We want his help, the help of his grace. However, this criticism, based on the story of Robert the Bruce, totally misconceives the scope and dynamism of love. Love is creative. Love is not just a subjective feeling. Love is an objective energy. If you love somebody with all your heart, then you change the world for them. If a child has been loved by its parents, that will change the whole way in which she or he will experience the world later on. Because of the love of the parents, the child will have a courage, trust, and hope that she or he would otherwise have found it difficult to achieve. By the same token, hatred is also an objective force. If a child has not been loved by its parents, but has been rejected, that will mark his or her life afterwards. And that child, when it grows up, will find it harder to trust and love others because it has not been loved itself. From this we see how love is an enabling force. Our love alters the lives of others. And if this is true of our human love, it is much more true of the divine human love of Christ our Savior. By loving us, he does not just set us an example, but he changes the world for us, giving us a meaning and hope that we could not otherwise discover. So the love of another for me infuses into me a transfiguring force, a transformative power. Love empowers just as hatred depotentiates. If this is true of interhuman relations, it is much more true of the love poured out for us upon the cross. Where love is concerned, the subjective-objective contrast breaks down. Now let's combine together the model of sacrifice and that of victory, and now that of example. We can discover a common theme that unites them together, and that is the theme of suffering love. What makes Christ's death a redeeming sacrifice is precisely that he offers himself willingly in love. Model 3. The victory of Christ is nothing else than the victory of suffering love. Model 5. Models 4 and 5, interpreted as I am trying to do, are simply two sides of the same coin. Christ's victory is nothing else than the example of his unchanging love. And the example of his love is itself a victory. So we can combine the sacrifice victory image with the example image. Joining these three models together, understanding each in the light of the other, we reach a firm and convincing doctrine of salvation in Christ. Then there is a final model, that of exchange. Let's think of Christmas. What do we do each December? We send each other greetings. We exchange presents. And that is exactly the meaning of the Feast of the Incarnation that we celebrate at Christmas. When Christ was born in Bethlehem, there occurred the greatest and most wonderful of all possible exchanges. Christ took our humanity. God became human. So we offered our human nature as a gift to Christ. We offered it through the Blessed Virgin Mary. And in exchange, Christ has enabled us to share in the divine grace and glory. An exchange of gifts. So, on this, my final model, salvation is understood in terms of mutual sharing, of reciprocal participation. As St. Paul expresses it, speaking metaphorically in terms of riches and poverty, though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that through his poverty you might become rich. 2 Corinthians 8, 9. The riches of Christ are his heavenly glory. Our human poverty means our fallen condition, our alienation, our brokenness. Christ shares in our brokenness, in our anguish, in our loneliness, in our loss of hope. And so we are enabled, by way of exchange, to share in his eternal life. St. Irenaeus of Lyon in the 2nd century expresses this point when he says, in his unbounded love, he became what we are so that we could become what he is. And St. Athanasius in the 4th century says the same thing, more briefly and directly. He became man that we might become God. He became incarnate that we might be embodied. He was humanized so that we might be deified. So here we have the idea of Christ sharing totally in what we are, and in turn enabling us to share totally in what he is. Think of the Garden of Gethsemane, the agony of Christ, when he says, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Christ experiences spiritual death. He enters into all the anguish of a suffering world, alienated from God. He knows from within, as one of us, all our loneliness, all our disappointment, all our despair. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our sorrows, says Isaiah, and that has been applied to Christ. All our infirmities, all our sorrows. And then on the cross, when Christ says, my God, why have you forsaken me? He who is himself God experiences at that moment the absence of God. He enters into the place where God is not, and yet God is everywhere. So what we have in Christ is a total sharing without any reservations. And that to me is the best of all the models for Christ's work. But as I've said, we should not be satisfied just with one model, but we should combine them all together. Now, how did I answer the man in the train who said, are you saved? I could have answered, yes, I am saved. But might not that have seemed rather overconfident? St. Paul, long after his conversion on the road to Damascus, expressed the fear that after I had preached to others, I might find myself rejected. God is faithful and he will not change. But we humans possess free will, and right up to the end of our life, we are in danger of falling away. So perhaps I should have answered the man, no, I'm not saved. But that doesn't seem very satisfactory. He could have replied, well, what do you mean by going about dressed in black like this? If you're not saved, you've no business to be a clergyman. Possibly then I could have answered the man, I don't know. But that's not a very good answer. He could have responded, if you don't know, you'd better go and find out. So I thought the best way of answering his question was to say, I trust that by God's mercy, I am being saved. Not I am saved, but I am being saved. Salvation is not complete for any of us in this life. Because it's not just a single event. It's an ongoing journey, a pilgrimage that is only completed at the moment of death. So that was my answer to the man in the train. But if you can think of a better answer, please let me know. Thanks.
So we have a little bit more time. This is the time for questions. If you have any questions, Zenius will answer, we can have a discussion.
Yes. Thank you for your time, Benjamin. A lot of us are, most of us here are in university, they're doing undergraduate or graduate studies, some on path to become an academic. And I would like to ask from your own lengthy experience with the academic scene on both sides of the coin, what are some particular dangers to the soul that come from academic life? What are some ways of overcoming these, and what are some particular gifts that the vocation of the academic can give to the Orthodox Christian?
Academic life is concerned in particular with asking and answering questions. And we shall find in university, especially if we are studying a subject like philosophy, that there is a somewhat negative approach in the world today among intellectuals. They dismiss the Christian answer. So we have got, studying in university, to look at the questions that are being raised in the secular world, and we have to search our own hearts, how do we answer these questions? That is to say that a university is a place of intellectual challenge. If we just remain safely as market gardeners growing tomatoes and cucumbers, we will not necessarily be faced by particularly searching questions. But in a university, that certainly will happen. And being in a university is concerned with the quest for truth. So we will be challenged in the university context. What is the truth of Christianity? Why do we accept this truth? How do we understand our role as Christians? So certainly the university in this way, if we are at all sensitive and open-minded, will be a time of self-questioning. Another thing about a university is, if it functions as it should, it is a place of freedom. If I was asked as a university teacher, what are you trying to do for us students teaching us in the university? I would answer, I want you to learn to be free. Notice that I say learn to be free. Freedom is a gift, but it's also a task. Freedom is not just something given to us without any effort or response on our part. We have to suffer and struggle in order to be free. But a university, to me, is a place where we are invited to discover our freedom. Until we go to university, we have probably lived at home. We have accepted the guidance of our parents and then perhaps rebelled against it. But in the university, we have a wide range of freedom that we never had before. And so, as well as being a place where we ask questions, a university is a place where we try to discover the true dimensions of human liberty. So that's two answers. I can think of a few more, but let's stop there.
Any other question?
Yes, please.
Your Eminence, we're really, really intensely in a culture that tells us that staying in a state of suffering is the worst thing that could happen to us, and that what we should do is find a solution to our problem right now. Do you have any pastoral advice or guidance on that issue?
Yes, thank you. First, let's take the example of Christ. He suffers and dies on the cross. But that is not the end of the story. Christianity is not just a religion of suffering and death. Christ is a victim, but Christianity is not just about being a victim. The death of Christ on the cross is followed by his resurrection. And the cross and the resurrection should be seen as a single event. So in the case of Christ, his death leads to life. His death is not the end of the story. The life that is in Christ is stronger than the death that is imposed on him, and so he rises from the dead. So the Christian story is not just about being a victim, but it is about the fact that by being a victim, you can come to a new life. We share in Christ's death as Christians, but we share also in his resurrection. So Christianity is not a religion of death and suffering on its own, but how death and suffering can lead to light and joy and new life. That would be the case in Christ's example. But then what about ourselves? If we are to achieve anything of significance, we must be willing to suffer for it. That would apply to success in our examinations in university, for example. If we have not suffered and struggled in our studies, we will not come to notable success. So, for us, as for Christ, suffering goes with new life. New life comes through struggle. And that would apply equally to helping other people. We cannot, in a decisive way, help other people simply from a distance, from a safe distance, offering words of advice. If we are ready to help people in their serious difficulties, we've got to be willing to share their burden. Unless they feel that we are to some extent involved in their pain and suffering, our words of encouragement won't carry much weight. That is exactly the meaning of my seventh model, exchange. Christ saves us by suffering with us, by entering into our condition with all its pain, and by living through that. And this would apply to any situation where we might hope to help other people. We must be prepared to make their suffering, their pain, our own. Only then will we be in a position to effectively support and help. And that even applies, in a somewhat reduced way, to teaching. You will not be a successful teacher in school or university unless you can see the difficulties in the minds of the people you are teaching. Unless you can, to some extent, share their difficulties. If you speak from a position of assured conviction, your words will go over their head. You've got to be willing to put yourself in their shoes. That's the only way in which you will be successful if you're going to teach other people. Be able to see the difficulties and problems that are in their mind. So, if we are to bring new life, hope to people, there has to be the element of co-suffering. We have to be willing, in one way or another, to enter into their condition. That is what Christ did, and that's what we have to do. A great saint of the 19th century, Rajas and Seraphim of Sarov, used to say, where there is no sorrow, there is no salvation. So, yes, salvation is not all about sorrow, but sorrow has to be part of the story. And Seraphim also said, the Holy Spirit fills with joy whatever he touches. And it's good to keep those two statements side by side. There was another question that we got.
I think you partially answered it. I have a lot of friends that are atheist, and in a lot of my discussions with them, I found myself inadequately describing the Christian faith to them in a way that they didn't understand God, and in a way that I wanted them to understand. And I was wondering, like, what would be the best approach towards trying to bring people to the faith, or not even bring them to the faith, but for them to understand Christianity?
That is a very large question, which there is no simple and single answer. I wish I could give you a completely convincing answer, neatly wrapped up, but I can't. However, let me say, try and say something. I find the most difficult question is the fundamental question, is there a God at all? If we come to believe in God, then it's easy perhaps to move from that to the Christian idea of God becoming human, uniting himself to us in the closest possible way, and from there to God accepting to suffer with us, dying on the cross, and from there to the idea that through death there comes new life. All these things hold together. But what about the first step? Is there a God? Is there a deep meaning to our life? My answer basically is this. When I look at the world around me, I see patterns of meaning. In evolution, there is an immense wastage. There is a great deal of suffering. But out of the process of evolution, we have more and more elaborate and meaningful patterns, eventually with the emergence of ourselves, human beings who are able to speak in a reasoned way. I am able to talk, and you, I hope, understand some of the things I'm saying. Is this not an extraordinary feature, the way we have grown in self-understanding and the ability to express ourselves through science, philosophy, and art? And is this just a matter of chance? Is this just a matter of chance that all of this meaning should have come out of apparent confusion? I see a world with meaningful patterns round me. And I ask, where does this meaning come from? As a human being, I look for an explanation. And to be told there is no meaning, there is no point in our life. All these apparent patterns of significance around us have just happened by arbitrary chance. That leaves me deeply dissatisfied. So belief in God helps me to understand why there is meaning, order in the world around me. Of course, there's also disorder. There is a problem of evil. But there's also the problem of good, the problem of order. Why? Where did this come from? And religion helps me to understand that. Then a second point, I have within me a sense of right and wrong. And so do all humans. We may disagree about what things are right and what things are wrong, but we all have this fundamental sense of right and wrong. And right is not simply what gives me pleasure, and wrong is not simply what causes me pain. Right and wrong are not explained simply by my own pleasure, my own advantage and disadvantage. So again I ask, where does this moral sense come from? And belief in God helps me to understand. So I would say belief in God helps me to see things as a unit in a way that nothing else does. Yes?
Kind of building off that question, I'm very involved in interfaith dialogue on my campus. I'm kind of wondering, how do we go about successfully going through interfaith and ecumenical dialogue? How do we conduct ourselves?
How do we go about successfully in ecumenical dialogue, discussions with other Christians? Yes, that's exactly why I've come to Buffalo to take part in the Anglican Orthodox discussions. And in any discussions with other Christians or with members of other faiths, the first thing we must do is to be truthful, to try and explain in the fullest terms what we believe. Not aggressively, but not apologetically either. In ecumenical discussions, we won't advance simply by compromise. We each have to express our faith in its fullest and richest form, not just a basic minimum. And let us hope out of this expression of the fullness of our faith, a greater understanding will come. So I don't think in ecumenical discussions we are here to compromise, to try and find the lowest common factor that will unite us. We want to unite in the fullness and richness of our different traditions. And therefore, without being aggressive, without attacking others, we shouldn't be afraid to speak freely and fully about what it is that gives us joy and hope. So, let us be honest, and let us believe that others will be able to understand. We needn't say to others, well, of course, you'll never understand this. Let's try and explain it to them. And not seek to impose our truth on them, but to share it with them.
There's another one. Huh? Oh, well, I saw another hand earlier. No? Any other questions?
I have no one.
Yes?
I
mean, yes?
It's a bit more of a personal question, Your Eminence, that you achieved quite some. You're very well known, at least in not just an Orthodox circle, in Anglophone circles generally, and have been for quite some time. I've said, even at the opening, people express admiration for you and quite often to you. On the other hand, I've heard your letters to Bulgaria are not answered, so it's not only admiration. But how do you deal with it? How do you try to maintain your humility in a context where you are asked to come to speak to people and people do give you praise? And you're in a public position. How do you go about trying to keep that Christian humility?
Perhaps I don't. Yes. However, that's a good question. What is the nature of humility? It is not to say, I am useless, I am unlovable, I have no purpose to my life. Humility is not self-hatred. Humility is not viewing ourselves with contempt. Humility, as I understand it, is to say, whatever I have is a gift from God, a gift brought to me through other people. I would say I have had many blessings in my life, And if I'm able to do any good, it's because of the blessings that I've received. So humility goes very closely with gratitude. The proud person is ungrateful and attributes everything to himself. The humble person, when they are praised, passes it on, says, yes, I praise God, I express gratitude to my parents, teachers, and friends, because it's through them that I've been able to do any good. So I think the proud person says it stops with me. The humble person passes it on to God. But of course, one thing we can never say is, I am a very humble person. Other people may choose to think of us as humble, but this is not a quality we can attribute to ourselves. So, when I'm praised, I try to, perhaps not in words, but inwardly, bless God for the gifts that have been given to me, because I wouldn't have been able to do anything if I had not been helped, if I had not been given these gifts. So that would be what I try to do. Pass the praise on to the person who really deserves it, and that's God. Yes?
Your Eminence, you mentioned that you were involved in Anglican Orthodox dialogue. We've seen in the Western churches a certain degeneration of, you know, the how much they are willing to accept the opportunity of the Christian message. Up in Canada, the United Church is having an open debate as to whether or not its clergy are required to believe in God. And in light of that, we've also seen an interesting curiosity and almost fondness from the Western churches to the Eastern tradition. In light of this, how worthwhile do you feel that the current dialogue between the West and the East on these issues is? Because the Russian Church, for instance, has cut off dialogue. But I know you are maintaining it, but I'm just wondering how worthwhile it is at this point.
That's a question I often ask myself. And from an Orthodox point of view, we have to say that the differences between Christians in many respects are growing greater. That at the beginning of the 20th century, Christians were closer to one another, and in particular, many more Christians in the West shared the traditional Orthodox understanding of Christ as Son of God, belief in the Holy Trinity, and acceptance of, for example, marriage as the lifelong union of one man and one woman. So that actually, as time goes on in the 20th century and now in the 21st, the differences between Christian communities seems to grow greater rather than less. But what I would say as an Orthodox is that within the Anglican Church, Episcopalian Church, and in other Christian communities, there are many who do believe very closely what we Orthodox believe. They are not all liberal Christians who call in question the Godhead of Christ and his bodily resurrection and the traditional understanding of marriage. Very many of them in the West agree with us. And we Orthodox ought to give these people our full support to help them. So that would be one reason why I believe that dialogue helps. That by explaining our Orthodox position and by listening to the others, we can help people in the West who believe as we Orthodox do. And there are many, for example, High Church Anglicans and many Roman Catholics whose faith is almost identical with our Orthodox faith. And it is good for us to get to know them and to support and help them. And their questions that they put to us may help us to understand our own faith better. So, for me, dialogue, even if it doesn't seem to lead anywhere very quickly, is better than silence and separation. I would add that the Church of Russia has not, in fact, broken off all dialogue with other Christians. We, in our Anglican and Orthodox dialogue, do have a representative from the Church of Russia. And the same would be true of the dialogue with the Roman Catholics. And I don't think that the Church of Russia has withdrawn totally from the World Council of Churches either. So actually the Church of Russia does remain in contact with Western Christians. The churches, the Orthodox churches that have broken off dialogue very largely are Bulgaria and Georgia. But Russia continues to be in contact. So, talking to one another, we may mutually deepen our own faith. That would be my defense of having meetings such as the one I've just taken part in. Yes?
Sort of an unrelated issue to that, quite often we see this sort of distinction, and it's sort of a mapping of the difference between churches and political differences. Like, you have liberal churches and liberal parties, and then you have conservative churches and conservative parties. And one of the things one of the results I find of this is when people are inquiring into Orthodoxy or into any other quote-unquote conservative denomination, the first thing they want to hear about is things like, what do you think about marriage, and what do you think about abortion, and so on and so forth. These are questions that you need to get, you have to start at the beginning, and this is jumping to like some of the outward implications of what we believe. So how do you acknowledge someone's concerns while refocusing the conversation on what they need to understand first, which is Christ, and then moving outward to the various social issues that are so much more widely talked about?
Yes. Religion is concerned with the whole of life, with human beings in their actual situation today. And so our faith in God religion is concerned with the whole range of human life, not merely with a narrow spiritual realm separated off from our daily existence, but religion is concerned, Christian faith, with our situation as human beings as we now are. And therefore, questions of poverty, of human rights, of abuse of children, all of this is something that we are concerned with as Christian believers. Politics is not concerned with the whole of human life. Politics is not concerned with how we pray, with our inner beliefs, but politics is concerned with very many issues concerning the human person with which religion is concerned. So they overlap. There is going to be an area where religion and politics are both involved, but of course in different ways, because our Christian faith is not based simply on human reason. It is based on revelation, on scripture, on tradition. So we come at the issues such as abortion, which may have a political aspect, but we come at it from a slightly different point of view. But we do interact, and therefore, as Christians in our witness, we do have to express a view on questions that are being raised in politics, but in another way. We should, as Christians, not seek to construct a little golden circle where we are safe and secure. We should be willing to go out into the marketplace and to meet others who have a different faith or no faith at all. So yes, we shall be obliged as Christians to express political opinions, but we do not express them merely as politicians. We take into account our faith in looking at the answers that we give. So there is an overlap here, but we can't identify our Christian faith with any particular political party, because we are looking at things from another point of view, I would say a higher point of view, than a secular politician can do. But we mustn't be afraid to bear our witness as Christians on issues that have a burning political significance. Disengagement is not a Christian option. We should feel involved and engaged, but not necessarily supporting any one political party. Yes.
There are currently efforts in the US to establish a Western right of orthodoxy as opposed to the typical Byzantine right. And I was wondering if your thoughts both on the theoretical idea of Western right, then how it's actually being put into practice. And also, is the phrase lex orandi, lex credendi, as we pray, so we believe. And I was wondering how that phrase would influence how we should think about a Western right.
Yes. In Britain, there are very small groups who are using the Western Rite. Their numbers are not very large. I think they come under the Russian Orthodox Church outside Russia. But I believe you have also small Western Rite groups here in America. Now, the Western Rite can certainly be seen as orthodox, because in the first millennium, when Christians of East and West were united, the Christians of the West used their own rites. And so we shouldn't say the liturgy of St. John Chrysostom is the only orthodox liturgy. Western rites can also be orthodox. So I would say, in principle, I certainly allow for the possibility of the Western Rite, whether in England or here in America. But I'm not sure whether to develop a Western Rite at this particular moment, in the specific situation in which we Orthodox in the West find ourselves, I'm not sure whether that will really help. The problem we have is that though we are using the liturgy of St. John Chrysostom, we are split into many different jurisdictions. We do not have full local unity among ourselves as Orthodox. Yes, we believe in the same faith, but we certainly do not have organizational unity. And we are keenly aware that these jurisdictional divisions cause a lot of trouble to us as Orthodox, and our witness is weakened in that way. To give you an example, many years ago, I, with one or two friends, intervened with the British Broadcasting Corporation, the BBC in Britain, and the BBC has religious broadcasts as part of its basic constitution, but we pleaded with them. We said, we are quite a large number of Orthodox in Britain, and yet we are hardly ever represented in the religious broadcasting on the BBC. we would like you to give us a fair share in the religious broadcast. And they said to us, yes, very well, but who can we deal with? We are not going to carry on discussions separately with Greeks, Russians, Romanians, Bulgarians, Serbs, Antiochians. We will only deal with one unified Orthodox representation. And we didn't have a unified Orthodox representation, so the result was we got nowhere. That's just one example of the way our Orthodox divisions often hinder our witness, that we could not speak to the broadcasting people and the other media with a single voice. So yes, we do hope to work more closely towards unity. We do now have episcopal assemblies, meetings of the bishops of the different jurisdictions. We've had such meetings in America for many years. We in Britain only for the last few years. So we are working a little towards a fuller expression of our Orthodox unity. But I fear that to bring in the Western Rite is going to complicate an already complicated situation. So I say to converts, the best thing is for you to become thoroughly familiar with the liturgy of St. John Chrysostom. There's nothing specifically exotic or oriental about this liturgy. It can be fully entered into by Western people. So I feel it's not yet the time to develop the Western Rite. This will complicate things unnecessarily. But if there are communities following the Western Rite, I'm perfectly happy to cooperate with them. I think we've exhausted
ourselves. Okay. Thank you, Ernest. Can we have a picture before we go? Can we have a picture with you with all these young people?
I always feel I ought to charge a small fee when I'm then I would be very rich.
So before you go, please come around to them here to take a picture. So